comfort ye, my people. My salvation shall not tarry.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, give us grace to cast away the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Now, in this time of this mortal life in which your Son, Jesus Christ, came to visit us in great humility, that in the last day, when he shall come again in his glorious majesty to judge both the living and the dead, we may rise to the life immortal. Through him who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence. As when fire kindles brushwood and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, so that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down, the mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you, who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you in your ways. But you were angry, and we sinned, because you hid yourself. We transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember iniquity forever. Now consider, we are all your people. The word of the Lord.
Show the light of your countenance, and we shall.
A reading from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. Grace to you and peace from God, our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always for you because of the grace of God that has been given you in Christ Jesus, for in every way you have been enriched in him, in speech and knowledge of every kind, just as the testimony of Christ has been strengthened among you, so that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ. He will also strengthen you to the end, so that you may be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful. By him, you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark. Glory to you, Lord Christ. Jesus said, "In those days after that suffering, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you will know that he is near at the very gates. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about the day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or at cockcrow, or at dawn, or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The downright apocalyptic readings that we've heard these last few weeks ring a bit differently this year. One could easily assume that apocalypse is the last thing that we want after the last few months that we've had. We've had quite enough of disruption and quite enough of endings. And faced as we are with yet another shutdown, partial though it may be, this return to virtual worship and political uncertainty, biblical apocalypse, while somehow in keeping with the themes of 2020, seems like the last thing that we need. We could all be forgiven for saying, let's just skip this apocalyptic stuff, we'll get it again next year anyway, and move directly on to our celebration of Christmas, of Jesus Christ coming to Bethlehem. But somehow these little apocalypses we've been hearing manage to speak to where we really are. The tumult and challenges of this year have primed us to hear them and to understand them in a way that we haven't for a long time. We are better able to cry out with the blind man on the road to Jericho, "Son of David, have mercy on me." And to join the prophet Isaiah in his prayer that God would tear open the heavens and come down. Even the prayer book's great litany resonates anew in this climate. From plague, pestilence, and famine, good Lord, deliver us. From all oppression, from violence, from dying suddenly and unprepared, good Lord, deliver us. And while it's not one of the specific petitions in the litany, I'm sure many of us are tempted to pray, from the captivity of Zoom, good Lord, deliver us. We cry out for that deliverance that only Jesus Christ can bring. We raise our plaintive cries for the deliverance of God. We raise them perhaps even for the judgment of God. For we know that God's judgment, always tempered as it is by God's grace and mercy, will inevitably bring about God's justice and that peace that surpasses all human understanding. We know that God's judgment will right the world. In that light, a heaping tablespoon or two of apocalypse starts to sound not just palatable, but a welcome addition. Something we can long for. Yes, God is coming to judge, but in doing so, God brings the promise and reality of Easter Day to each and every corner of the earth, so that no place at all is lacking the light and beauty of Christ's healing and life-giving presence. That is what the prophet Isaiah is crying out for, and it was in that same hope that the earliest Christians fervently prayed, "Come, Lord Jesus." That simple phrase, "Come, Lord Jesus," is one of the earliest complete liturgical prayers. It is a versatile prayer. It was prayed at baptisms, at Eucharists, and in times of great distress. "Come, Lord Jesus." And this prayer is at its heart an Advent prayer. It is a prayer for Christ who has already come into the world once to come again, for him to come again in the hearts of his faithful people, for him to come again in the bread and wine of the Eucharist, and for him to come again on the last day, cinematically descending from the clouds and robed in dreadful majesty. This cry for Christ's return was a central part of the early church's worship. It was prayed by a community that was often persecuted, often had to resort to hiding, and was oppressed. They longed for Christ's return. They looked for Christ to deliver them from this in-between time, this time that is bracketed by Christ's death, resurrection, and ascension on the one hand, and his coming again in great glory on the other. Over time, persecutions ceased, and Christianity became increasingly more comfortable. And as that happened, the church's emphasis on that simple prayer, "Come, Lord Jesus," dwindled. But each Advent, we are reminded that this prayer is spiritually essential to our lives, no matter what we think of our circumstances. Over these 4 short weeks, as we look forward to our celebration of the beginning of Christ's earthly ministry at Christmas, we simultaneously contemplate his return. In doing so, in holding these 2 events in tension, we glimpse the world as it really is, suspended like a wire between those 2 events. We are reminded that our life here on earth takes place in what amounts to the final intermission of a great drama of the world's redemption. And we are reminded that though we might not be conscious of it all the time, we truly do long for those theater lights to dim and for the final act to begin at last. It is the start of that final act that Jesus exhorts his disciples to keep alert for, to keep awake for. He calls on us to watch for the moment of his return in power and glory, so that the fruits of his victory won 2,000 years ago may be tasted the whole world over. My friends, that is good news indeed. It is news worthy of our attention. It is news worthy of our anticipation, even for our longing. Now, none of this is to say, Jesus is coming, look busy, like so many preachers on the subway in New York. In Jesus' parable, the master of the house is not looking for feigned activity, but for attentiveness to the work that is to be done in his absence, for real preparation, for care to be paid for those things that really matter. We're not being asked to clear off the tables and clutter and shove them in drawers or in some back room. Instead, we are called to an attentiveness to the world as it truly is, suspended between those two events, and to our roles as heralds of Christ's coming. That doesn't look like standing on a street corner and shouting that the end is near. It doesn't look like writing off or ignoring the world in which we live. It looks like living our lives in the expectation of Jesus' imminent arrival. It looks like taking to heart the assurance that even in our darkest moments, even when all hope seems gone, Christ is poised to break into the world. And that as we wait in faith, Christ abides with us still. In this in-between time, our call is to keep both ends of that timeline in sight, to keep Easter Day and final judgment ever before our eyes, and to not let our present moment obscure creation's ultimate reality. In his rule, Saint Benedict instructed his monks to keep death before their eyes daily. It is a practice that is as transformative for those who undertake it as it is difficult. It results in a changed outlook on the world and one's place in it. Keeping Christ's resurrection and return ever before our eyes is equally transformative as a practice. To view the whole world through those lenses is nothing other than transformative. And it propels us to live lives in light of our remembrance of Christ's death, our proclamation of his resurrection, and our awaiting of his coming in glory. Not one of us is called to do all of the work needed to bring about God's kingdom. Jesus has already done that work. Instead, our work is to wait actively and to participate in the small bits of work that are before us, and to allow ourselves in all of that to be shaped by the new vision that we are given in Christ Jesus. My friends, this is our work in this in-between time, to patiently, persistently respond to the vision we see when we view the world through that lens, and to participate with joy in the victory that has already been won for each of us, so that when God does tear open the heavens and come down, we are prepared to make our response in words like those of Charles Wesley's. Yea, amen, let all adore thee, high on thine eternal throne. Savior, take the power and glory, claim the kingdom for thine own. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Thou shalt reign, and thou alone.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth,
of all that is seen and unseen.
We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Let us pray that Emmanuel will come to us, saying, "Come and save us." For the Church, the Fellowship of Christ, for the work of the Bishop Nominating Committee, for the grace we receive from God, for the wise use of all our spiritual gifts, for the hope we yearn for in this Advent season. Strengthen us as we wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ. Come, O come, Emmanuel. Come and save us. For all the people of the earth, for refugees and migrants, particularly for parents and children separated from each other, for the transition in the federal government, and for those being named to government positions, for the healing of mistrust and divisions, for all who cry out for racial justice and equity, for people everywhere affected by the coronavirus, for workers enduring risk and exhaustion, for the wisdom and the will to keep people safe and healthy, for those who serve our country, particularly Christine, Logan, Wade, and Trace, for their families, and for the safe return of those far from home. Restore us, O God of hosts, show the light of your countenance, and we shall be saved. Come, O come, Emmanuel.
Amen.
Save us. For the work of East End Cooperative Ministry, for families who will receive gifts from the toy drive this year, for Calvary parishioners supporting the food pantry, make us signs of your presence as you draw near. Come, O come, Emmanuel.
Come and save us.
For all who suffer in body, mind, or spirit, for Elise, Diane, Benjamin, Bob, Anna, Kathleen, Bev, Conroy, Henry, Tim, Larry, Luke, Daniel, Jean, Bob, Luke, William, Lisa, Marlon, John, Karen, and all those who have been commended to our prayers. For people who are ill with coronavirus, and for all those who care for them. For hospitals and healthcare workers overwhelmed by the virus. For everyone worn out by anxiety and uncertainty. For people throughout the world living with HIV and AIDS. For those struggling with addiction and those in recovery. For caregivers. For those who we now name. Stir up your strength and come to help them. Come, O come, Emmanuel.
Amen.
For those who have died, for Scott Edwards, for all who have died from coronavirus, and for those who grieve for them, for victims of gun violence, for all who mourn, for those whom we now remember. In your great power and glory, send angels to gather your beloved. Come, O come, Emmanuel.
Come and save us.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways. To the glory of your name.
Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
We welcome you today to Calvary Episcopal Church in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Glad you've joined us for worship. This evening at 5 p.m., we invite you to join us for Lessons and Carols, a wonderful way to continue the first day of the Advent season. You'll see over my right shoulder is our Advent wreath we have here, and the first purple candle is lit. Next week, two purple candles. The third Sunday of Advent, two purples and a rose. Then the fourth purple candle on the fourth Sunday of Advent. And then on Christmas Eve is the white candle. It's a way to mark the time preparing for the first and second coming of Jesus. On Christmas Eve, we will have one service at 4 p.m., and we will put that online so you can watch it at the time of your preference, whatever works best for you and your family, anytime that afternoon or evening. And then on Christmas Day, we will have a service online at 9:30 a.m., We will have a Christmas pageant this year. It will be all virtual. It is being put together and edited from various families filming in their homes with children singing in costume, and we'll have that up by Christmas Eve and we get all the videos in. Thank you all very much who have made a financial pledge to support Calvary Church in this upcoming year. We're very appreciative of that and invite everyone to join us in sharing in the gifts that we have. Tonight at 8 p.m. will be our first service of Compline. We'll be doing on Sunday evenings throughout the Advent season. You can see a note about that in the Sunday or Friday email, which is on our Calvary webpage. Compline is a short service at the close of day. It's in the Book of Common Prayer. It's a wonderful way to shape the end of the day and prayers. I'll be led by one of our parishioners and look forward to that each Sunday night of Advent at 8 p.m. Tuesday is the last day to bring in your gifts for the holiday toy drive benefiting those in need in the East End. So please remember Tuesday, last day for sharing of gifts for the holiday toy drive. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Let's roll.
The Lord be with you, and also with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because you sent your beloved Son to redeem us from sin and death, and to make us heirs in him of everlasting life, that when he shall come again in power and great triumph to judge the world, we may without shame or fear rejoice to behold his appearing. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy.
We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you made known to us in creation, and the calling of Israel to be your people, and your words spoken through the prophets, and above all, on the Word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he'd given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory. And we offer a sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection unto your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where with all your saints we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen."
the gifts of God for the people of God. Come, Lord Jesus, and dwell in my heart in the fullness of your strength. Be my wisdom and guide me in right pathways. Conform my life and actions to the image of your holiness, and in the power of your gracious might, rule over every hostile power that threatens or disturbs the growth of your kingdom, who with the Father and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns one God in glory everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. Now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. The peace of God that passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of God's Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God.